Please switch off your video. Unnish.
Okay, sir. I have already switched off.
Okay.
Audio.
So are you also looking, I mean, this is this also visible, recorder, recording, all of you? No.
Recording is not visible.
Okay. So I was just talking about the scaling, supply voltage scaling relation with the delay. When the supply voltage is scaled down, then and when especially it is approaching towards the threshold voltage of the device, then the delay increases asymptotically. So there will be an optimized supply voltage value which could provide us the best in terms of power dissipation as well as an optimized delay. So supply voltage is one of the important tool as we discussed earlier, and the supply voltage scaling is done. There are different class of supply voltage scaling. It could be static voltage scaling, or multi-level voltage scaling, or dynamic voltage and frequency scaling, or it could be the adaptive voltage scaling. So in static voltage scaling, the supply voltage of the entire chip will be scaled down to a lower value, you can say, and all the sub blocks of the chip will be driven by a single power supply. In multi-level voltage scaling, there will be more than one supply voltage level that will be actually driving the chip. Some sections will be driven by a higher supply voltage, another section will be driven by a lower supply voltage. So typically two or three different supply voltages are actually realized in this scheme, multi-level voltage scaling. In dynamic voltage and frequency scaling, however, there will be a large number of voltage and frequency pairs. Basically those voltage and frequency pairs will be one of the voltage and frequency will be selected based on the workload at that particular instant of the time. Whereas in adaptive voltage scaling, this is entirely based on a closed loop control system, and the software will actually judge the workload, and accordingly a voltage and frequency will be selected. That could be independently selected, or depending upon the workload to optimize the power dissipation, pair of, you can say, voltage and frequency will be selected in this adaptive voltage scaling. But there is any value of voltage in the given range can be selected, and similarly the frequency can also be selected. Okay, so the difference between the dynamic voltage scaling and adaptive voltage scaling is this: in dynamic voltage and frequency scaling, there will be setups, some voltage frequency pairs, whereas in adaptive voltage scaling, there will be range of voltage and frequency. So either one of the voltage and the frequency level will be selected in adaptive voltage scaling automatically by the operating system based on the current load. So now static voltage scaling, if you recall, we have already discussed about the different approaches of static voltage scaling. The first one, at the different level of abstraction, the techniques are used. For example, at the transistor level, the constant field scaling is one of the approach. So in constant field scaling, the other dimensions of the transistors are also scaled down along with the supply voltage to maintain the electric field constant. So that will help to maintain the performance of the scaled transistor, and the transistor will offer, of course, the better, even better performance in some cases at the lower supply voltage. Whereas in this architecture level approaches, as obvious, these are done at the architecture level, parallelism, pipelining, and the combination of parallelism and pipelining are also used. And apart from these two, the voltage scaling using high level transformations are also used. During the high level transformation, some techniques may be used of voltage scaling that that will actually with main emphasis on the power reduction. Basically, high level transformations are done in order to improve in order to get a better performance in terms of circuit speed and the required area for the function realization. But if we compromise those factors, then we can have some we can let the chip operate at the lower supply voltage, and at the same performance the power dissipation can be reduced. So next is this we have as this was also discussed in the class, the static voltage scaling is the parallelism technique was already discussed. The in parallel parallelism technique, the hardware is duplicated. So you can see that there are n parallel hardwares are used, and these hardwares will be operated at lower frequency. So they will have they will have sufficient time, I mean longer time to execute a given instruction, and that time slack because of the reduced frequency that is actually traded off with the supply voltage scaling, so that the n number of blocks will be performing the you can say the same task, so that throughput will be maintained. But at the same time, since the longer time is available for each and every clock, each and every block, so the supply voltage of the different blocks will be scaled down, and the power dynamic power dissipation can be reduced. So here in this slide, basically parallelism is shown with the for a 16-bit adder implementation. So 16-bit adder is implemented here, you can see, and another block is actually duplicated here, and here you can see the latches are operating at F reference frequency, but in parallelism the different blocks can be operated at the half of the frequency, and because now the longer time more time period more time is available to execute the task, so voltage here V reference can be scaled down to V reference by 2. And therefore, the power estimated power, it's a rough estimation. It could be around 2.2 times C reference, V reference by 2 square into F reference by 2. So, 2.2 C reference is, of course, because this block is duplicated here. So, the total load capacitance will be increased more than 2 times, because we have to also consider the impact of the extra interconnects, and therefore in this case if we look at the total power, then it turns out to be 0.277 P reference. So if we look at this table, then we can summarize we can summarize the performance after invoking this parallelism. So you can see that the area is if VDD is not scaled, the area has to increase because the copy of the original hardware has to be created. So area is increased 2.2 times. Power is also increased because now the two blocks are to be operated, but the throughput is increased. So the number of functions that will be performed will be just twice. But if we go for supply voltage scaling, so area remains 2.2. Throughput, if we can compromise with throughput, then the power can be reduced significantly. So from 2.2x to now it comes to 0.227. similarly, the pipelining can also be useful for the supply voltage scaling. Basically, it provides a scope for the supply voltage scaling. And in pipelining, the function is divided into a sub-block, you can say. And if we divided a bigger function into smaller functions, then of course the critical delay will be smaller in the different sub-functions which are actually which are a division of a bigger function. And since the critical delay of the sub-blocks are now reduced, so they can be operated at the lower supply voltage. So the supply voltage can be even scaled down with the help of if the pipelining is invoked. And the summary of invoking pipelining in to reduce the power dissipation is this. Here in the first in this column, second column, you can see without VDD scaling, with VDD scaling. So area is 1.15 time in both cases, because although the function is divided into sub blocks, but again the interconnects will increase. So the area will increase. Some additional resistors will also have to be, some latches has to be used. So the area is actually increased in both cases. Power, if we don't go for VDD scaling, the power requirement will increase. And the advantage of this pipelining is this throughput that has been increased 2 times. But if we go for the supply voltage scaling, then no improvement in the area, but the power is reduced to 0.28 time if we maintain the throughput at the same level. And of course, if we invoke or if we use both pipelining and parallelism together, then the performance is going to be even better. So if parallelism and pipelining are invoked together, then you can just see this table to realize to just to see how the performance of this hardware is increased. So area is increased 2.5 times. It's greater than that of parallelism, and also greater than that of the pipelining, because now the extra hardware has to be created, and also large number of interconnects will be used. So power, if we don't go for supply voltage scaling, power requirement will be 5 times more, but the throughput increased also 4 times. So here the power is traded up with throughput, but if we maintain the throughput at the same level, at the constant level, then we can reduce the power significantly. Okay, so it's only 0.1125. Okay, so these are the techniques for static voltage scaling at the architectural level: parallelism, pipelining, and the combination of these two. Then I will talk about the voltage scaling using high level transformation. Okay, so high level transformation is done in digital circuit design. And if you look at the overview of a design methodology, so you can see that the system level specification of the problem will be given. And then based on those specification, the hardware software will be co-designed. I mean, it will have to be decided which portion of the problem will be implemented by software, which portion will to be implemented by the hardware. And then basically by hardware software co-designing, we get the behavioral level description. From there, through the high level synthesis, we go to the register transfer level, and then from logic synthesis, we go to the logic level, and from logic level to finally we go to the hardware layer level. So this is the overview of the design methodology you can see. And high level transformation come here. High level transformations are basically used to optimize the specification at the behavioral level. And these are basically done in order to reduce the area requirement and increase the throughput for the given problems. So the high level transformation could be the dead code elimination, or it could be common sub expression elimination, it could be a constant folding, or it could be a loop unrolling. So I think this topic you will be discussing great detail in your it will be discussed in detail in your digital system design. Here the main objective is to just to show you how this high level transformation could be useful for the power reduction. So this will be actually taking one of the high level transformation, which is loop unrolling, to show you how this could be useful to supply voltage scaling and eventually the minimizing the power dissipation. Okay, so here a first order IIR filter is given, and functional description of this first order IIR filter is this: yn equal to xn plus k time yn minus 1. This is represented here. The diagram, this diagram is just the implementation of the representation of this function. And the same function is here shown using the directed acyclic graph. And in directed acyclic graph, basically the two things are considered. These are basically sequencing of the events and then the scheduling. So sequencing means, let's see that here there is a summation plus and there is a multiplication. So which one has to be done first? So the events, the sequence of the events are actually chosen properly, and then the events are scheduled. So here you can see that using two clock, this function is implemented. So here first this multiplication k time yn minus 1 is being performed, and then the outcome of this is added with xn in the next clock. So two clocks are basically needed to compute one sample yn. So if you take the reference here, VDD is, let's say that this was implemented at VDD equal to 5 volt, throughput was 1, and power is 1 unit. Then we can take this, we can use this as a reference for our further discussion. So the loop unrolling is one of the technique of high level transformation, and in loop unrolling is basically done here to compute the two samples at the two samples together. So yn minus 1 is xn minus 1 plus k yn minus 2, and yn is computed here, yn equal to xn plus k time yn minus 1. And if the scheduling and sequencing is done for the two samples, you can see that the two samples here are calculated in, let's say that the 4 clock, okay, 4 clock cycle. So if we compare the performance of this loop unrolling with that of the reference here, then you don't see any improvement, because the two samples are calculated in the 4 clock. So for each sample, again the 2 clocks are required, and the power requirement for per sample still remains same. Throughput, there is also no change in the throughput. But if some other techniques like distributivity and the constant propagation, if these are invoked, then there could be a significant change in the performance. So Here y n minus 1 is first computed, x n minus 1 plus k y n minus 2, and then this y n is represented in terms of y n is x n plus k y n minus 1, and this y n minus 1 is substituted here in order to get this expression x n plus k y k x n minus 1 plus k square y n minus 2. So this can be implemented only in 3 clocks. Here you can see, so 2 samples are computed, y n minus 1 and y n, in 3 clocks only. So we can use this fact to I mean, of course, if you don't go for the supply voltage scaling, then the throughput is going to increase now because less number of clocks are required to execute the two. And however, the power requirement increases. But if we again, if we can compromise with the throughput, so if you can compromise with the throughput, then we can reduce the supply voltage to increase the critical delay. And if the supply voltage is scaled down to 3.7 volt from 5 volt, then we can see that the power requirement is reduced from 1.5 unit to only 0.6 units. So this is significant improvement in the power. So again, here the basic concept is the critical delay can be compromised, can be increased, because the 3 clocks are only required, and if we can increase effort to increase by reducing this VDD, then we can be able to reduce the power requirement. Okay, and here the pipelining is also invoked. So if pipelining is also used along with the two property here, distributivity and constant propagation, we get the further improvement. And we can see here we'll be able then to reduce the power, will be reduce the supply voltage from 5 volt to 2.9 volt, and the power is reduced from 1.5 unit to 0.5 unit. Okay, so I suppose that since these topics have been already discussed, so I didn't go into the great detail, just it was to refresh the basic concepts to you, so that our journey and our further discussion will be comfortable with those discussions. Okay, so I'm leaving this slide. Then the second technique for the supply voltage scaling, the multi-level. First one was static voltage scaling. This is multi-level voltage scaling. So in multi-level voltage scaling, let's say that the two different supply voltages are being used. Okay, one will be the high supply level VDDH, another one will be the lower supply level VDDL. And in a given circuit, there could be many paths for the signal propagation, and the one which has the longest delay is called the critical path. So the units, the devices that are placed on the critical path, they can be operated at higher supply voltage, so that higher supply voltage, and the devices that are on the non-critical path, they can be operated at lower supply voltage, so that even the increased delay will not have create any problem, because even increased delay of non-critical path is less than that of the critical path. So this is the strategy used, and this strategy reduces the power significantly. And this is implemented, this strategy, multi-level voltage scaling strategy, is implemented at micro level, standard cell level, as well as the macro level or the functional level. So if it is done at the standard cell levels, then we must say that on the critical path, the gates that will be chosen from the standard cell library will be operated at the higher supply voltage VDDH, And on non-critical path, the gates that will be chosen from the standard cell library will be operated at lower supply voltage. So even increased delay because of the lower supply voltage will not give rise to any issue. Okay, am I audible to all of you? Can anyone say something?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. So, because of as a result of this multi-voltage scaling, you can see just you have to look. You should look this graph. This is basically here the multiple supply voltage. Basically, this is critical delay is plotted considered here at the x-axis. And basically, this is the number of paths you can say in a given circuit. So, if this, if a single supply voltage is used, then this is the general distribution of the different paths in a given circuit. So, paths with number of paths with very small delay, they will be less than in the mid region. You can see. The large number of paths will have medium delay, and then again smaller number of paths will have longer delay, and this is basically the critical delay. There will be very few, or let's say one or two paths that will have the longest delay. So this is critical delay. But when this multi level voltage scaling is implemented, then the path distribution is changed. Now you can see that now there will be large number of paths with longer delay, but still the critical delay is not changed. Critical delay remains same, only the paths with lower delay are actually shifted towards the higher delay side. But this is the things that are actually giving us an opportunity to reduce the power dissipation. So in at a standard cell level, to implement this, what is done, the clusters are created. So you can see that low VDDH clusters and high VDDH cluster and low VDDL cluster. So the critical path is actually, you can see here, this is the critical path and it is in high VDDH crystal cluster. And the low VDDL cluster here can be operated, I mean gates of this cluster can be operated at the lower supply voltage. So this clustering is done in order to supply, in order to bias the different gates at the requisite supply level properly. So proper for proper floor planning and other things. For proper properly supplying energy to the different gates, this clustering is done. So just like this this technique, as I said, is implemented at the standard cell level, this can also be implemented at the macro level, at the functional level. So the basic concept, however, remains same. Even in this case, if a critical path is if a particular function is not on the critical path, then that function is can be operated at the lower supply voltage. For example, this multiplier is, let's say this could be critical path, let's say. So if this is a critical path, this is not a critical path. So this multiplier number 3, this can be operated at the lower supply voltage to reduce the power dissipation. So in this approach, you can see 10 to 50% power reduction, from 10% to 50% power reduction can be achieved. Okay, so this multi-level voltage scaling seems to be very, very attractive, but of course there will be associated challenges. And these are the major challenges to implement the multi-level voltage scaling. The voltage scaling interface will be issue, because one cluster is operating at lower supply voltage, another cluster is operating at the higher supply voltage. So when signal has to move from one cluster to another cluster, there could be issue, because let's say that a signal is moving from a low supply voltage cluster to high supply voltage cluster. So in low supply voltage cluster, the highest level is, let's say, VDD low, and for high supply voltage cluster, the one level is VDDH. So there is a difference between these two. So this could create a problem. How this will create problem, we'll see later on, and how these are eliminated, we'll also discuss that. Then the converter placement, the proper placement is an issue. What is the suitable, most suitable place at which the high to low and low to high level converters will be placed. Then of course the floor planning and routing will be challenges because of these reservations that of making clusters. Then static timing analysis may be issue, power up, power down sequencing, how to power up and power down the entire chip in order to reduce the power dissipation. Clock distribution could be an issue, and the low voltage swing can also be issue. So among these different issues, we'll be mainly talking about the different voltage scaling interfaces. Okay. So multi-level voltage scaling interfaces, here you can see.
The slides are not showing, sir.
Again?
Oh. Yes, sir.
Slide is not visible again, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I have to try once again. I think there is a technical challenge. I have to again restart it.